And as you go from 15 years old to 20, you're going to have to find a new you. And then 20 to 25 and 30, when you get married, you got kids, it just keeps changing. I mean, I'm in search of my potential right now. Like, what else can I do?
Born in 92 on the block with the sharks, cut from a different cloth, y'all would get ripped apart. You want a diamond, then you gotta get it in the dark. We dropping nuggets like Carmelo went to Rucker Park. Now we eating from state to state, we scrape the plate. I put my eggs in a basket, took a leap of faith. I took a chance, now we growing, see the impact. Decoding success with special guests, now let's bring Matt.
Grant, or I should call you the Money Bunny Rabbit, as you just referred to yourself, man.
Hippity hop, hippity hop. You where I got to just show me the grass.
I love it, man. I am so grateful for you taking the time out of your day to hop on here. So thank you for hopping on.
Oh, dude, I love this idea of decoding. You know, I like the idea because I'm a coder. Like, I'm a coder, not a technology coder, but I've always been interested in figuring out, dude, there's got to be a way to do this thing, right?
100%.
And I look to my neighbors, my uncles, my brothers. I think we all are looking for, through other people, you know, the how to decode, how to the mystery lock.
That's what it is. That's what it is. That's exactly why I have individuals just like yourself hopping on here. Because listen, I aspire to be where you're at, right? Like, I want to be my version of Grant Cardone, right? I don't want to be Grant Cardone. I want to be Matt Labrie.
Yeah, there you go.
That's exactly why I have people like you hopping on here. So again, I'm grateful. And Grant, listen, I always kick this show off with no BS, no fluff. I just hop right into shit. First question right off the bat for you. How do you personally define success?
It changes. I mean, you know, the definition, this is the definition that like just keeps moving. And I know everybody's like, hey, when's enough enough? You know, you got the plane now and you got, you know, you live in the big, the condo in the sky and you got the businesses and blah, blah, blah. But, dude, it just keeps changing, man. When you find out what you're capable of, you know, when you're a little kid and, you know, you're just interested in playing a little game on your hands. And then you grow up one day and you're like, whoa, man, I could actually be in a real game. And the outcomes could be really, really cool. So the game just keeps changing. I remember my first apartment deal was, I bought one piece of property, 1113 Sheffield, Bel Air, Texas, a little cedar shake house on the outside. And it was $78,000. I was terrified, dude. I was like freaking out. I was so tripped out at that time. I put $3,000 down, maybe $5,000 down on that house. When I went to the bank, I had never done a loan application. My financials were on the front and the back page. I would double print to save paper. That's how much I didn't understand about anything.
Yeah.
That I thought if I double printed, you know, use both sides of paper, that I would actually save enough money that one day I would have something. And,
sure.
You know, that was 28 years ago. I bought that house. We closed $400 million worth of real estate last year. And it was only like four deals. It was like four and a half deals maybe. So, you know, it changes, man. Success, for me, success is when I discover a new potential, you know, a new thing that I can do, a new possibility. I think most people that are listening to this are going to find that to be true. You know, the Gronk retired this weekend from the NFL. He's going to have to find a new Gronk. And as you go from 15 years old to 20, you're going to have to find a new you. And then 20 to 25 and 30, when you get married, you got kids. It just keeps changing. I mean, I'm in search of my potential right now. Like, what else can I do?
I love that. Now, it's safe to say that process of being in search of your potential is definitely uncomfortable at times, right? So how do you find yourself dealing with that feeling of uncomfortableness? I saw that you just put out a video on Instagram recently about, or, you know, you compared growth and the uncomfortable feeling of growth to a tree's roots breaking through the concrete, right?
Yeah.
And I could not agree more, you know, more with that, because I'm personally feeling super uncomfortable right now. Like, I just went through a trip from hell because I just put myself through this burden. Not even a burden. It was something I wanted to do. Grant, I want to speak 100 times in 2019. I've spoke 25 times already, right? So I want to speak 100 times, and I want to speak in 48 states. I was just in Florida. I was in North Dakota, in Fargo, North Dakota, and I actually had to cancel Houston, Texas, because I felt so fucking uncomfortable. Like, wow. To the point, I just felt it, and it pushed me back, right?
Yeah. So, what happened to you in Fargo, man?
You want to know what, Grant? I'm going to keep it real. I flew from New York City to Chicago, which was fine. Chicago, I was stuck for the night, and Chicago's not a bad place to be stuck, right? Chicago's pretty beautiful. I'm in Chicago. They can't get me to Fargo direct, so I fly to Minneapolis. From Minneapolis, I freaking drive 4 hours, and I'm doing this by myself, right? I don't have a road manager. I'm not at that point in my life where I have that team, you know?
Yeah, of course.
So I don't know, man. It was that feeling of stress, uncertainty of what's going to be on that road, a road I've never really traveled before, both, you know, mentally and physically. You know what I'm saying?
So, dude.
That's what it was, man. And it just added up. And, man, anxiety, worry, fear, like all of that just.
Dude, look, here's the deal, man. You can't, bro. You just got to, like, it's not going to go away. I had a guy in here today. He makes $1 million a year. He's done Tony. He told me this year he's done Tony. He's had Tony as a coach, had a meeting with Gary Vaynerchuk, another guy in the commercial space, a commercial real estate space, and me. Okay. He's hired me. He meets with me every month now for 12 months. And I'm like, bro, you got to pick. I mean, I don't know how to tell you this, but Tony's going to tell you to have a state change. I'm not saying any of these people are right or wrong, by the way. I only know what's right for me. So this is not a jab at anybody, except I only know what I have been able to do, right? So fear has never gone away for me. Cold plunges. Dude, I've tried it all, bro. Enemas, essential oils, meditation, prayer. I mean, I would pray to Allah, Jesus, and Muhammad, and Jehovah, dude. I would pray to the lava god if I thought it would make fear go away. It ain't going anyplace, bro, because you just need to lean into it, man. You need to lean into the fear. There's so much jet fuel in fear. So you can't cancel a deal ever again, ever, for any reason.
Yeah.
Never. You got to you want to keep it real. You cannot say no to a deal ever, particularly in the beginning stages. No matter what, no matter how. I remember a guy told me when I was 26 years old, I was going through a really rough time in my life, 26, 27 years old. He's like, you need to show up even if your eyes are bleeding. I have employed that idea for 35 years now. No matter how I feel, I show up. I try to say yes. I bet you I say yes to 98% of the things that people bring to me. I show up like 99.9% of the time. When I show up, I try to show up at another level. I'll tell you a story. On 9/11, I was in Indianapolis. And I was probably 40. Let me see, 9/11, when was that? 2001. So I guess I was 16. I was 45 years old, 46 years old. I had a career. I was making money, dude. I didn't have a road manager either, by the way. And freaking 9/11 happened. I was in a room speaking to a room about 200, 300 people. First of all, I had to keep in Indianapolis, middle of the country. Country went into shock. I had to keep 250 people in a room because if they didn't, if everybody left at 9:30 in the morning when everybody saw it going down, I was going to have to give refunds to everybody. Okay, now everybody's like, oh, goddamn, you're just thinking about yourself at 9/11? Yeah, that's right. Okay, because I couldn't do anything about 9/11. I didn't know how to get bin Laden. I didn't know what was happening. Okay, I wasn't part of the government. I needed to keep 200 people in a room. Otherwise, I was going to have to give 200 refunds. It was going to be like $75,000 I didn't have. The next day, I had another gig in Toronto, man. Okay? I finished that day. I think it was a Tuesday or a Wednesday. I finished that day. Find out when 9/11 was, what day of the week. And finished that day. Bro, the whole country had been shut down. Okay? Yeah, it was Tuesday afternoon. Wednesday, I had to be in Toronto. But look, the Canadians would not have blamed me for not showing up after 9/11.
Yeah.
Airlines were shut down. Like, there was no way to move around. I got in my car, bro. I rented a car. And I drove to Toronto, and I did that gig.
Damn.
Because no matter what, bro, like if somebody says you got to come, you got to come.
No, I agree.
Because Houston's going to haunt you until you fix it. Because now you're carrying that around with you, bro, the liability of knowing you canceled Houston.
100%. I feel it, man. I feel it. I'm not trying to live in the past.
Yeah, so you got to call those guys up and say, dude, what can I do to fix that? How can I solve your problem? Like, you got to make that go away in your own mind. Like, literally do whatever you got to do to make that thing go away. Because I know it's going to kill you if you don't.
Yeah. Now, we're kind of touching on this subject. So I'm curious, you know, I've heard you talk in the past about viewing your challenges as fuel.
So yeah, let me just go back, because your question was, how do you deal with discomfort, right?
Yeah.
You gotta be like, I need to be uncomfortable all the time. There was a period in my life where I became so comfortable in what I was doing and I hated myself. I was showing up at gigs. You could put a quarter in me. I could be unconscious 1 second and the next minute, because I was just doing the same thing over and over again. And I wasn't there. And I was comfortable. I was so comfortable. I was no longer alive. And, you know, that happened to me in high school. I got so comfortable. I'm like, dude, I'm just going to do drugs and go to school, because it was easy for me. My friends were comfortable. Then I made a little bit of money and I got comfortable. Like, don't get comfortable. One of the things I like about Damon's book, Broke, you know, The Power of Broke, is Power of Broke is really talking about stay uncomfortable to where you're forced to do stuff. Like, I'm forced to do stuff that Damon John doesn't have to do because he's got ABC doing it for him. See, I got to go freaking kick walls down. He can make a phone call, Damon John. You know what I'm saying? I love Damon, right? But just stay uncomfortable, dude. That's that way you grow more when you're uncomfortable. And that's that image of the tree that we've all seen breaking through concrete. We're like, whoa, how's that possible?
Now,
sorry to interrupt you.
No, not at all. You're not interrupting me. Listen, we're talking. Question, you know, like, do you ever feel like, or from your personal experience of being uncomfortable, do you ever feel like your performance is off? You know, because this Thursday I got back, you know, a speaking gig here in New York City, and I'm talking only for 1 hour, you know, 1 hour I'm talking. I just feel like I'm so off. Granted, everything's rolling. I could just be my own worst critic, but you know, my question is, do you ever feel like you perform to a lesser value when you're uncomfortable?
Yeah, but it's still better than not showing up.
That's true.
I mean, you got no chance of being great if you don't show up, man.
Yeah.
So, and nobody else will know you, you know. So it's just, look, one thing that I've done in my life that's really benefited me is that I have never sought perfection. I have never sought to be perfect. I remember I was involved in this men's movement when I was like 30, let's see, maybe, yeah, 30, late 30s. And there was it was kind of a weird thing, dude, but I was all into it. It was a lot of fun. We'd do these weekends, go out into the woods and bang on drums and talk about our father issues and read poetry to one another. And, you know, it was crazy, but a lot of psychology, a lot of guys, you know, they would tell you what was wrong with you. And it was interesting, right? It was introspective But I remember this guy that was really into the Native American thing. What was his name? Walter. Walter was an artist, and he was deeply involved in all the Indian stuff, like particularly the big killing of the Indians. I forget what that There was a massacre at Big Knee. It wounded me. It wounded me. He did all this art on Wounded Knee, actually made a piece for me. I can't believe I'm telling you this, dude. So check it out. He told me that the Native American Indian, the chiefs would say, when they would do blankets and stuff, they would always put an imperfection in the blanket to remind themselves they weren't God. And I'm like, dude, that's some good shit right there, dog. And he's like, why? What'd you get out of that? I said, I don't have to be perfect anymore. So from then on, man, I must have been, late 30s. Keep in mind where I was in my deal. Nobody knows me. I'm just starting. I had some ideas about some industries that I was doing some stuff in. I was starting to write, not books, but training manuals and educational. This is way before the internet, right? Workbooks and manuals and curriculums that I would go sell to companies. Dude, I decided that day I never have to do a perfect one again. That has made me, promise you, that has made me hundreds of millions of dollars.
Yeah.
Saying I'm not going to be perfect, but I'm going to get to the market faster than anybody else. And so, look, I go there with my imperfections. You know, my first book that I wrote, Sell or Be Sold, had hundreds of misspelled words. And some guy called me one day. He's like, hey, man, you got misspelled words all over the book. I said, dude, do you know about the Native American? Our Indian forefathers, man, I'm paying respect and homage to the great gods.
By letting them know I'm not a god.
Every page has got a misspelled word, bruh.
I love it. That's great stuff. Now, You know, that brings me to that question I just asked, you know, like, how do you find yourself viewing those challenges as fuel? You know, like we're all going to go through challenging times. We're fucking humans, right? But life isn't always just peaches and cream. So how do you flip that switch in your mind to really view it as something that you could use to your advantage?
Well, like peaches and cream, dude. Do you even like peaches and cream?
Hell no. I like peaches. Cream I could do without.
Do you have any peaches in your refrigerator right now?
Probably not. I got strawberries, blueberries. That's about it.
Exactly. You don't even like peaches, man. You pass them up in the grocery store. So a lot of this stuff, like I don't even think we believe that, like, we just hear these things, you know, that look, bro, none of it's comfortable, but I have my own plane.
Is the plane comfortable?
It's pretty comfortable. It ain't perfect. Right. It ain't perfect, but I got to tell you, dude, when I get on that thing, I'm like, this is worth every goddamn uncomfortable thing I've ever done in my life.
Yeah.
Okay. When they fill that thing up, bro, and I can take my family to London without checking through TSA, and I'm packing a Glock, right? And I don't have to worry about anything. When I leave London, I'm like, you know what? I don't want to go home. I want to go to Sicily tonight. I got to tell you, that has been worth every uncomfortable thing I ever have done in my entire life.
Yeah.
And so this is what I would just tell people. If you read the 10X rule, it's about, some people are going to hear that and say, I don't need all that. Well, of course you don't. Dude, nobody needs that. But once you have it, you're going to be like, you know what? That was worth it. Nobody needs it, okay? I don't need a jet. I don't need to decide I'm going to leave London and fly to Sicily. Hell, man, I could probably just stay at my house every day if I wanted to. You know, I need is oxygen. I need love. I need, you know, food. I need water. All this other stuff is just extra. But if that is possible. So the payoff's got to be big enough, man.
Yeah.
See, I think your question, a better question that you would ask here is, dude, how big's the payoff got to be to make the uncomfortable not matter?
For sure.
Now, I didn't know this. I didn't have anybody telling me this when I was 25 or 30 years old. I should have been going bigger, so much bigger early on. Okay? You, Matt, are capable of so much more than you're thinking about.
So
So, dude, what I would do is I would realign the goals. I would start thinking about, okay, I want to do 100 gigs this year. I've already done 25. I want to be in 48 states. How about this? You want to do 180 countries. And, you know, you see what I'm saying, dude? Just because, bro, you will achieve the goals you have already. Houston will become a non-issue. You will achieve all those goals. And then you're going to look up and say, wow, that was nothing.
Yeah.
Every kid goes through this. Man, I want to ride this bicycle. I want to get really good at this bicycle. Like, oh my God, like you're in a spaceship. Okay. And then when he's 15, I want to learn to drive a car. He throws the bike down in the garage, doesn't even put the kickstand down, just tosses it. You see what I'm saying? The goals, as we set our goals, we can't see big enough to say, oh, dude, I don't want to ride a bicycle. I want to build a spaceship. So you can do any of that, bro. The payoff's got to be bigger than the discomfort.
For sure. Now, how do we, you know, I would love to focus on that payoff, right? And that big picture all the time, right?
Yeah.
But living too much in the future does cause, you know, some anxiety and shit like that, right? So how do you find that equal balance of being present with also keeping that in mind?
So what I do, and me and Damon have had some arguments about this, is I write my goals down. I write my goals down every day, my future goals down in present time. So I see a lot of people do this, you know, I am rich, whatever, right? And they put this on their phone and they look at it. Dude, you're looking at something that was done yesterday or the day before. That's not present time. Okay. Present would be, I'm going to rewrite it again today. As the new me.
Yeah.
Right? I am married with two beautiful children. I wrote that down 1,000 times before I ever found my wife. I wrote it down every day. I wake up in the morning, write it down again at night. Write it down in the morning, write it down at night. Write it down in the morning, write it down at night. Okay? I wrote down, hey, I'm worth $100 million. I must have written that down. I bet you I wrote that down 10,000 times. I didn't know what I was going to do with the 100. I just thought, man, if I could get to 100, you know, I'd have some choices. The jet was never on there. Living in Miami was never on there. You know, so some of the specifics were never on there. The timing was never on there. I know some people say, look, a goal without a time is just something else, some sweet saying. I've never had a date on any of my targets.
Yeah,
but I wrote them down in the morning. I wrote them down at night. So I'm living in the future, right? I'm writing my future down. But I'm going to work every day making a phone call so I can pay my bills.
I love it.
So that everybody understands, like, guys, I grew up with nothing. Like, I was 25 years old. I had no money. I was 40 grand in debt. More importantly, I had no respect from the community where I lived. Okay? People knew me, and what they knew about me was not good. So I had a lot of liabilities. I was the black sheep of my family, and I was not trusted by the little town I lived in. So I had to overcome all that, but I knew that I couldn't overcome that in a day. You can't fuck your life up for 10 years and think that in a month everybody's going to trust you. So what I did, dude, I just put my head down. I made amends with everybody I could. Everybody that would forgive me did forgive me. Everybody that thought I was a punk and a hoodlum and all that, they just kept thinking that. And I put my head down and I started creating a new me every day. And I did that by showing up every day, being uncomfortable every day, and getting my finances right. The first thing I fixed in my life was my money. And I see a lot of people trying to fix. I tried the other way. I tried to fix my life and not worry about the money. Money was something I could measure. I either had it or I didn't have it.
Yeah.
And the marketplace, it's like a thermometer, dude. Like I don't know if global warming's real or not. I know this. When I go out and I engage someone and I convince them to give me money for something I did for them or promised to do for them, that I can read the thermometer. I know for sure something's happening. And that's the only thing I really trust, you know. It's like, did something happen or not? Not my feelings. My feelings have misled me. Your feelings misled you when you left Fargo.
100%.
100%, dude.
Yeah.
See, if there'd have been $1 million there, you'd have shown up, dog.
Hell yeah, I was showing up for that.
You'd have had to, bro, because you follow the money. We all follow the money. If the hook is big enough over there, If it had been 100 million, you'd have walked on glass.
I would have walked barefoot, 100%.
Exactly. You'd have said, hey, drag me behind a truck. Let's roll.
I agree, man. I agree. I definitely agree. Now, you know, we're talking 10X here. We're talking stuff like that. So if someone's listening right now and they feel like they, you know, they want to live that 10X lifestyle, right? But they feel like the goals and the dreams they have are as big as they can get. Would you give them any advice to get past that limiting belief to get bigger?
Well, I think, yeah, I mean, I think a lot of people don't confuse the 10X lifestyle with the Lamborghini lifestyle.
Okay? For sure.
10X people are, they're workers, man. And they're it's a big think. A Google, for instance, I got a message from Google last Friday, I think it was. Guy wrote me, he's like, dude, the internal at Google is discussing 10X right now. The top people at Google headquarters, they're discussing how they can use 10X right now. So these are big thinkers. These aren't, but they're big doers, bro. They put their money where their mouth is. They buy big campuses, big investments. Like, it's not just, I'm gonna drive a Lamborghini and I'm gonna be a big shot. They're not fakes, dude. 10X people are real people. So the limiting belief things, look, it's never about material stuff. The guys that I know that kill it, they're not going for the yacht. You know, they're going for something. That's just part of it, right? Nobody really goes for the yacht kill. I mean, the real guys don't go for the yacht kill. What they're going for is something else. And then they look up one day and say, dude, I got a couple hundred million sitting around here. Let's just go ahead and blow it on a yacht. Because none of it about it makes sense at that point.
Yeah.
So 10X is about work, but the 1X is about nothing. You know?
For sure.
Just get by. That's what people need to fear. The middle class trap is what people should fear. Not poverty. Poverty is not what you should fear. And wealthy is not what you should fear. What you should fear is everything in between. It's like purgatory for the Catholics.
No, I get it. I definitely get it. I definitely get it. No, it makes sense. It all makes sense. Now, talking 10X, talking all this stuff, you know, we need to be committed, right, to the work, right? We need to be 100% all in. Do you feel that it's possible to be committed to 100% to more than one thing at a time?
Oh, yeah, sure. Doesn't mean you'll be any good at it, though.
True.
You know?
True.
I mean, I've never been able to do that very successfully. I've tried it with a lot of different stuff, too. So, I mean, try to commit to two waves at the same time.
Yeah.
You're gonna probably miss them both. So, I've never been able to do that. I hear guys talk about running two and three things, and I'm like, okay, well, whatever. I mean, I've just never been able to do it. I know some guys can juggle. Most of them are magicians that never make any money. Looks good on stage, you know. Yeah, that's good. That's good. That's nice entertainment. But, I mean, after a little while, everybody's tired of him.
Yeah. No, I ask just because a lot of individuals hop on the show and they're like, you need to be all in. The only reason I bring it up because you have 10X there. I remember in one of the last chapters of 10X, you talk about, you know, just – taking the leap of faith, right? Both feet, not testing the water, be 100% committed. That's exactly why I brought that up. And a lot of people that hop on the show are just like, you got to be 100% all in on one thing, you know? So,
until the one thing gets going, though. You see, you need to get one thing, scale that thing until it's like, okay, that thing's working. And then you add a second thing.
Yeah.
Right? When you add the second thing, by the way, when you put your attention on the second thing, the first thing should keep going. Okay, if you put your attention on the second thing, you move too soon. So when I put my attention on my second business, first of all, I did a partnership with the second guy and gave a majority of the company away so he could run the second thing. So I had one thing and a quarter.
Yep.
But most people think, oh, I got to own 100% of everything. No, you don't, man. The way to scale, the easiest way to scale is to get great at this one thing. The easiest, simplest way to scale. Warren Buffett talks about this, by the way. He's like, the easiest way to get a second flow of income is to buy it. It's not to go start a company or learn another craft. Get great at this one job, this one thing you're doing over here, whatever that thing is, get great at it. It should be paying a surplus of money. If you're great at it, it should be paying you surpluses. Then take the surplus and simply buy second flow. That second flow should be indestructible, uninterruptible, and consistent, and it should pay you even if this one got squashed. They really shouldn't be related to one another.
100%.
So dude, the way to surf two waves at one time is, like, you know, to get really good at this wave and then to buy, you know, pay somebody to surf the second wave.
Yeah.
This is what the wealthy people do. Wealthy people buy. They buy waves and flows. Warren Buffett doesn't start companies. He buys companies that are in place already. He's like, boom, I'll buy that. He buys flows, right? So, see, the rest of it's the entrepreneurial world. This whole industry of entrepreneurs now. It's a forest industry. It's basically an industry of illusion, and it's manufactured ideas. Everybody mm-hmm. wants to be an entrepreneur now. I have never wanted to be an entrepreneur. All I ever wanted to be was a business guy that made money, that delivered a great product to the marketplace and people paid me, and then I made a profit. To me, it would be respectable to be a profitable business as opposed to a losing business.
For sure.
I have never, ever, until the last two or three years, I never used the word entrepreneur until I realized I should use it as a hashtag on Instagram. Before that, I had never even, I think I heard the word a couple of times in California and I thought, oh, you must be unemployed. Because the guy would say, I'm an entrepreneur. I'm like, oh, I told the girl I was dating. I said, he's out of work. I said, it must mean he's out of work. Because otherwise he'd say, I own a laundromat.
Yeah.
Right? So anyway, a lot in that answer. I hope I didn't offend anybody, but.
No, it's the truth, man. Listen, sometimes the truth hurts.
What's the business, dude? I mean, like a drug dealer doesn't say he's an entrepreneur. He's like, oh, dude, I'm a drug dealer.
Yeah.
You know, let me show you what I got. The rapper doesn't say I'm an entrepreneur. The rapper says what? Dude, I'm a rapper.
Yeah.
Now, when he tries to start transitioning to the next thing and he's not sure what he is yet, maybe he gives himself this name. Entrepreneur. But what I always wanted to be was a guy in business that hired people, scaled a lot. I wanted to hire a lot of people. I got 129 employees. I'd like to have 12,000 employees. That would be more respectable to me than having 129.
Yeah. I love it, man. I love it. Now, I want to respect your time, but I'd love to squeeze a couple more questions out of you. The first one, I always ask these two questions to end the show. Let me start here. What was a piece of advice that you were given that you didn't want to hear, but it proved to be true over time?
Good. That's a good question, man. No, I've never been asked that question before. Something I was told.
That you didn't want to hear, but it proved to be true over time.
Well, man, there was this guy. I was selling cars. I was 23, 24 years old. I was fucked up, dude. I was doing drugs every 40 minutes. I don't think I could go a whole hour without doing a drug. It was terrible, bro. Like 18 times a day, I'm consuming something. I was a mess. I weighed 130 pounds. I weigh 176 today, you know? So I'm 40 pounds lighter. Just imagine what I look like. Gray. So this guy, he was trying to buy, he was buying a car from me. I think he was buying like a Celica. Maybe a little two-door Celica, Toyota Celica. And, or maybe it was a truck. I don't know. I can see him right now. I think his name was Ted or something. This is 35, 40 years ago. And he looked at me and says, what are you doing, son? And he didn't say anything else. I don't know if I went unconscious, blacked out or whatever. That's all he just, what are you doing? And then he looked at me and says, when are you going to get it together, man? And then he said this. Do you're better than this. Never said anything about the drugs. Didn't say I was a drug addict. Didn't talk about my price was too high. It was weird, bro. It was like an intervention from God or something. It was like somebody sent somebody, like an angel. The next time I would get a piece of advice was in a hospital after I'd been beat up. I had 69 stitches put in my head and face. I got stitches. I mean, Johnny, maybe you can tighten it up. But you're on the little thing right here. Anyway, when you get close to me, you can see all these scars over my eyes. One over my mouth. One between my eyes. You see them, Johnny? Can you see them? Okay. Anyway, on this side of the head, I think there's one little dip over here. But inside, on the top of my head, bro, it's just tracked. And I was in the hospital, and the doctor's like, son, you know you're a drug addict, huh? Now, they didn't know. I mean, the doctor knew. And I didn't want to hear that, man. I said, no, man, I got this, right? Now, I had been beat up because of drugs and had to be put in the hospital. I was in the hospital for 3 days, swore I'm done. Okay, checked in like Wednesday night, 11:30 at night. And I'm done, dude. I'm done. I wake up the next morning. I'm doing drugs by 7:30 in the next morning, dude. The only thing that kept me from doing drugs between 11:30 and 7:30 was because I was sleeping. Yeah, I didn't want to hear that, man.
Yeah, that's tough. But look at you now, man.
Look at me now, man. Now, you know, the other things I've heard that are true, by you're cocky, you're arrogant, you don't know how to communicate. Good. All that's true, by the way. You know, if your presentation was different, you know, if you just thought about your audience more and spent more time connecting with people, you would be so much more respected in your space. I'm like, yeah, you're probably right, dude. You know. I try to do it, but I can't. I just don't last very long.
No, you're authentic, man. You're authentic. That's what draws people to you. You know, like I wouldn't.
I don't think so. I think that probably pushes more people away from me than draws people to me. But you know, whatever.
Listen, you can't be
I'm
fake.
I'm back to the blanket, dude. I'm back to that blanket.
I love it. Listen, I want to respect your time, Grant. I would ask you where people could find you on social media, but everyone knows where to find you on social.
So, dude, but look, if you guys know where I'm at on social, look, if you're following me on YouTube and you hadn't subscribed to the channel, hey, do that for me. And then when I do a show, we do a live show on YouTube every day. Comment on the show. Like, I like to see people's comments. So just because you might know I'm bopping around here or there, make sure you follow the whatever the channel is. Like on Instagram, I'd love for more people to turn their notifications on, comment. I actually look at those feeds. I don't hire people to look at them for me. I look at them LinkedIn. I'm extremely active on LinkedIn, and I like engaging with people. And you know, I might miss a couple of days, but I will see you in there if you're showing up. So
now you're just at Grant Cardone everywhere, right?
Yeah, exactly. We try to stay with the simple thing.
I love it. Listen, what's going on with the next growth conference? You got any news on that? You're going 10x, 350,000 this time?
Dude, we going big, dog. We going big, man.
I love it.
You know, your little man there, your little man over your left shoulder right there, the little devil. He, you know, he's like, hey, first time he met me, there was 2,200 people in the room. First time Damon John did a deal with me, it was 2,215 people in the room. He walked in, he's like, God damn, dude, you a good salesman. I said, what you talking about, man? What you talking about, little man? And you know the whole story about how I hooked up with him?
Yeah, I heard it.
Yeah, so I couldn't get Damon to call me. I couldn't get, you know, everybody wants something from these guys, right? So anyway, I got him to agree to do the gig. He came and did the gig. He's like, man, there's a lot of people here, man. God dang, man, how you do this, little man? I said, you're the little man. and so I said, the next one I do is going to be bigger. The next one you're at, bro, it's going to be bigger. 10,000 people the next one, then 34,000 at this last one. So on his birthday, he came. So he's a cool dude, man.
He's the man. I love it. Grant, thank you so much for hopping on here. I truly appreciate it. All the insight, all the value. I'm grateful. Thank you again, man.
Appreciate you, bro. Hey, get over Houston as fast as you can.
I'm going to try. I'm trying. Thank you again.
born in 92 on the block with the sharks. Come from a different cloth, y'all would get ripped apart. You want a diamond, then you gotta get it in the dark. We dropping nuggets like Carmelo went to Rucker Park. Now we eating from steak.